Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I rise to support on my own behalf and on behalf of the All India Trinamool Congress the 119th Constitution Amendment Bill, which after an amendment is passed will become our 100th Constitution Amendment. At the outset, I would like to congratulate our Honourable External Affairs Minister for bringing this historic legislation before this House, and also for making a statesmanlike speech in opening this discussion and debate. Our External Affairs Minister referred to the Radcliffe Award of 1947. The roots of the problem that we are going to solve in this Parliament later today go back to the tragic partition of 1947. The irony of that partition was captured best by the poet W. H. Auden in his poem Partition, where he wrote about Radcliffe. This is what he had said. Unbiased at least he was when he arrived on his mission, having never set eyes on this land he was called to partition. Time they had briefed him in London is short. It's too late for mutual reconciliation or rational debate. The only solution now lies in separation. He got down to work, to the task of settling the fate of millions. The maps at his disposal were out of date and the census returns almost certainly incorrect. But there was no time to check them, no time to inspect contested areas. The weather was frightfully hot and the bout of dysentery kept him constantly on the trot. But in 7 weeks it was done, the frontiers decided, a continent for better or worse divided. The next day he sailed for England, where he quickly forgot the case as a good lawyer must. Return he would not, afraid, as he told his club, that he might get shot. Radcliffe was not a good surgeon. Partition was often referred to as a surgical operation. Not only did he bring misery to the people on either side of the lines that were drawn on 1947, but like any bad surgeon, he left swabs inside the patient. These were the enclaves that are going to be exchanged now, today. The Chitmahals, as we call them in local parlance in West Bengal. As I speak today, my mind goes back to 1971, a date to conjure with in South Asian history. I was merely a high school student, not even in college, and I was used to go with my pediatrician father, Dr. Shishir Kumar Bose, to the Bonga border, where millions of refugees had come from what was then the eastern wing of Pakistan. I had seen poverty in Kolkata, but I had never seen the kind of human misery I witnessed in 1971 in the refugee camps around the Bonga town. But there was something else. I also used to visit the Netaji Field Hospital in a village called Bokchara, where the brave wounded soldiers of Bangladesh's Mukti Bahini used to be brought across the border, and public-spirited doctors, surgeons from Kolkata would operate upon them. That is the only time in my life that I have seen operations being conducted open, in the open. And there was not even any saline. I have seen David Jol, coconut water, being used in place of saline. And these Mukti Joddhas sacrificed their all. Our Indian soldiers made huge sacrifices. What we witnessed in 1971 was a glorious freedom struggle against one of the most brutal military crackdowns in modern history. After the victory of 16th December 1971, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, Bangabandhu, came back. And I remember on the 17th of January, my father met him in Dhaka. What was the border like? He just drove across in an ambulance carrying medical supplies for newly independent Bangladesh. That was the kind of border we saw in 1971, people wanting to help each other to live a life of dignity. And then, of course, in 1974, our External Affairs Minister has referred to the historic agreement made between Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman and our great Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. And it is a pity that 41 years have passed before this Parliament could ratify that agreement. Today, the words of Bangabandhu, his historic speech on the 7th of March, are ringing in my ears when he said, "Prottek ghore ghore durga gore tolo, rakto jakhon diyechi, rakto aro debo, edesher manushere mukto koira charbo inshallah." And he brought freedom to the people of Bangladesh. He offered to give more sacrifice in blood so that the people of Bengal, East Bengal, could be free. Now, when we look at this agreement, the 1974 agreement, the protocol signed in 2011 between Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, I had the privilege of meeting the Prime Minister when they gave an award to my father posthumously just 2 years ago. I find that what is really historic, what is really positive about this bill that has been brought by this government? We have in this bill carefully balanced, and we are protecting and promoting the national interest, the state's interest, and the human interest. The national interest, because this bill, once it is passed later today by this House, will bring about a revolutionary transformation in the relations between India and Bangladesh. And I agree with the External Affairs Minister that we will be able to rekindle the spirit of 1971. And after that, when you go to ask the people of Bangladesh and the government of Bangladesh for trade facilities and transit facilities, they will respond to you in a positive manner. So the national interest has been supreme. I know that earlier this week there was a little temptation to falling prey to narrow partisan interests. But what is important today is that the people of Assam also rose to the occasion, and the temptation was resisted. National interest was put above party political interest. Second, the state's interests have been protected. It was a real privilege for me to work on the Standing Committee of External Affairs with Shashi Tharoor of the Congress, with Mohammad Salim of the CPIM, my own colleague Mumtaz Sanghamitra of the Trinamool Congress, and so many of the BJP members and members of the other parties belonging to the ruling coalition. It shows the value of the Standing Committee system in our parliamentary democracy. And in the report, the unanimous report that we tabled in this House on the 1st of December, we protected the state's interest. This is what we said about the earlier history. We said closer consultations at the highest political level between the central government and state governments would have been desirable. The committee, while appreciating the efforts to keep the state governments on board, would therefore suggest the government to effectively coordinate with them on all matters and resolve the lacuna, if any, related to the actual implementation of the accord on the ground. And I'm very glad, I'm truly happy, I have to tell the External Affairs Minister, that she has conducted consultations at the highest political level as we had wanted, and she has spoken several times to our leader, the Chief Minister of West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee. We had also said the committee expect that the central government and the state government of West Bengal will arrive at a consensus on the issue related to the rehabilitation package. All the humanitarian issues should be resolved in advance, including assistance from the central government in this regard. And I trust, as the External Affairs Minister has assured on the floor of this House, that the rehabilitation package which has been sent to her by the government of West Bengal, led by the Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee on the 6th of December 2014, will be available to the state so that we can build infrastructure and also give a true life of dignity to those in the enclaves who have been leading a miserable existence for the last 67 years. And that is the most important aspect of this bill. We are protecting the human interest. I am so delighted today that our veteran elder statesman, Advani ji, Murli Manohar Joshi ji are sitting here this afternoon as we are debating this Constitution Amendment Bill. And I am remembering our visionary former Prime Minister, Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Because what we are going to do today is going to be a solution of an intractable problem. A solution that is going to be found in the spirit of insaniyat. Under the sign of insaniyat, human beings are taking precedence over territory. Small amounts, small pieces of territory that are only going to be notionally exchanged between the two sovereign states of India and Bangladesh. Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I would like to say that sometimes I hear certain justifications for this agreement, and I can understand the ruling party, in order to satisfy their recalcitrant constituents in a certain province, may often have to make those kinds of arguments. I often hear that this particular piece of legislation and the final settlement of the land boundary between India and Bangladesh will help us resolve the problem of illegal emigration, of smuggling across the borders, and so on. Now, that may well be a byproduct of the settlement that we are going to reach with Bangladesh. But let us remember that this historic piece of legislation is actually meant for the benefit of the law-abiding citizens of India and Bangladesh. Once the entire boundary is demarcated, I would like to see that innocent, law-abiding citizens of India and Bangladesh should be able to cross the border with dignity. And I would urge our External Affairs Minister to have consultations with the Home Minister so that a whole series of integrated checkposts can be set up along the India-Bangladesh border. Because we want ordinary people to be able to cross without difficulty. We want music to flow across the border that separates the two Bengals. We want theatre groups from the two Bengals to come to each other and to have their performances. I have spent a lot of time as a student in Bangladesh, going about all the districts, working in district record rooms, and I have seen how much the people of Bangladesh admire Deshobandhu Chittaranjan Das, Sharat Chandra Bose, and Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. I have seen the best performance of D.L. Roy's Shah Jahan play on a stage in Dhaka, not on this side in Calcutta, even though we have great theatre personalities and theatre groups in West Bengal. And some of them actually now belong to our party, the All India Trinamool Congress. So I would like to say that let us gift this historic piece of legislation to the people of the two Bengals, and also to someone whose birth anniversary, Ponchisha Boishak, we are going to celebrate all over the country in 2 days' time. Tomorrow is, and the day after tomorrow. Ponchisha Boishak is either on the 8th of May or the 9th of May. Now, he not only wrote the national anthems of our two countries, India and Bangladesh, but all of the songs that he wrote during the Swadeshi movement of 1905 were inspirational for the Mukti Jodha of Bangladesh in 1971. Bangladesh hridoy hote kokhon apuni tumi ki oporup rupe bahir hole janoni ogo ma tomaye dekhe dekhe aakhi na phire. You know, we cannot turn our eyes. We have always envisioned our state Bengal and also Bharatvarsha as the mother, and that is the spirit. In those days, we used to recite Jivanananda Das's poetry, Banglar mukh ami dekhiyachi, tai prithibir roop ar khunjite jai na ar. We have seen Bengal's face, that is why we don't need to go out and find beauty in the rest of the world. So that is what I'm being sort of reminded of here today. And finally, I would simply like to say that there is one song, just, you know, of course, there were many other songs that were referred to by Aluwalia ji, you know, Bhupendra Hazarika's famous song, Ganga Amar Ma, Podda Amar Ma. But let us remember that during the heyday of the Swadeshi movement, Rabindranath Tagore wrote a very beautiful song, Amra Milechi Aaj Maer Dake. We have actually gathered here at the call of the mother. We are answering the call of the mother in passing this historic legislation in the Lok Sabha today. So again, on behalf of everyone in this house, it is such a great moment to see that we have risen above all political party differences. We have protected the national interest, the state's interest, and the human interest today. So let us, as has happened in the Rajya Sabha, rise to the full stature of this house and unanimously pass this Constitution Amendment Bill. And let the message go out to the whole of South Asia that we want peace and development for the poor and obscure who live all across this great subcontinent. I thank you very much, Deputy Speaker.